Good morning and welcome to Christchurch on this Sunday, the 6th of December, the second Sunday of Advent. It is an absolute joy to welcome you here as we worship together, as we learn together, as we sit in the presence of God together. In a moment I'll be lighting the Advent candles, which is why I'm up this bit of the church for this bit. But before we move into our worship, I just want to make sure that everyone watching knows what we are up to for Christmas. We've had to think really hard this year about how we can enable as many people as possible to participate in what we have to offer this year, and how we can do that as safely and as flexibly as possible. And we are really excited about what we have planned. There are some fantastic things. The first thing to let you know about is our Nativity Trail, which is around the local area. Seven houses have lent us their windows for Advent, so from the 1st of December to the 24th, they will have the Advent story in their windows as you go round, and they're numbered 1 to 7. The map for that is available on our website, on Facebook, email the church office, contact us, and we'll make sure you get that. And at the end of that, the final station is an amazing nativity scene on the church gates, and we would love you to take a selfie in front of that and send it to us so that we can see you participating in that, see you having fun. We would ask as you go round that, if it does get busy, we have had a lot of interest, just be aware of social distancing as you do that. If there are people already looking at a window, just respect the houses that have offered us their windows and just hang back a little bit and take it in turns to have a look and have a wonder at the questions that are on there as you wander around. The second thing is that we have Christmas services coming up. They're not our normal Christmas services. The style that we normally do just would not work. We're not allowed to sing in church, and we're not allowed to pack the church full of children running around dressed as nativity characters, much as we absolutely adore that. But this year we do have some two amazing services, which we will repeat a number of times to try and enable as many people as possible to get in there. So the first of those is an all-age festive Christmas, and that is on the 13th and the 20th of December at 4 p.m. and also on Christmas Eve at 4 p.m. And we would absolutely love you to come to that. You do need to book a place. If you turn up on the day, the likelihood is we won't have room to let you in. So please book a place with the church office. Let us know your preferred date. They are booking up fast, so please do get those bookings in as soon as possible. Because if we need to run extra services, we need to know that now so we can schedule that in and get the cleaning and things done. The other service that we're running is a more reflective service, Christmas by candlelight. We can't all sing the carols together, but we can listen to the carols. We can listen to some amazing music that Catherine, our worship pastor, has put together with the worship team. And we would absolutely love you to come to that. As we listen to that, we experience the Christmas story through those songs and through readings from the Bible. Those are on the 13th and the 20th of December at 6:30 p.m. Again, you do need to book your place in the church office, but please do that. We would absolutely love to see you. The final thing that we're also really excited about, which we're still in the planning stages of, but we will do, is on Monday the 21st of December, so the first week that the kids are off school, I think, we are going to do carol singing around the local area, again run by Catherine, our worship pastor, and she will take a small group of the worship team, socially distanced, around the parish. We will let you know where we're going to be, and we would love it if you would come out of your houses and join us and sing those Christmas carols while you're on your own property. We can't gather together, but we're hoping to include as many as possible in that. Please do get involved in those things. This is an odd little Christmas, but it is still a Christmas where we remember God come down to earth. God come down into the mess and the brokenness of humanity to save us, to bring us light and life and peace, whatever our circumstances. But for today, as we move into our worship, in a moment I'll pray the prayer of preparation and light the Advent candles, and then later on we will have reading and prayers from the Agayaman Adua family. Angela and Ose will be reading and praying with us, and their children as well, and it will be lovely to see them. And then Catherine will lead us in sung worship, and I will be back to help us to think about the Bible reading a little bit. But for now, as we steel our hearts, as we come into God's presence, as we allow his peace to enter us, and as we reflect on all that Advent means, we pray together our prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And so we come to lighting of our Advent candles. One was lit last week, and that was the one that helps us to remember the matriarchs and patriarchs of the faith, those people that we read about in the Old Testament, the founders of the faith, the ones whose example we follow as we follow Jesus. And then today we light the candle that reminds us of the prophets, those who spoke out God's word in difficult times, who always spoke God's truth, and in the midst of difficulty spoke of God's hope and God's light and God's peace and God's kingdom. And so as we light this candle, I will then say a prayer. As we say, God our Father, you spoke to the prophets of old of a Saviour who would bring peace. You helped them to spread a joyful message of his coming kingdom. Help us as we prepare to celebrate his birth, to share with those around us the good news of your power and love. We ask this through Jesus Christ, the light who is coming into the world. Amen. And so now we will have our reading, and then I will be back to help us to think about what that might mean for us today.
Today's reading is from Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Hail, O favoured one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and considered in her mind what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favour with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end."
And Mary said to the angel, "How shall this be, since I have no husband?" And the angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your kinswoman Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For with God nothing will be impossible." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Well, remember that day, the one that this all began. I was at my parents' house in Nazareth. I was at home, just a normal girl. I was supposed to be doing chores, but I'd actually sat down by the window for a little while. I was enjoying the sun on my face, the sound of the birds singing, the breeze in the trees. Moments like that always feel God-filled to me, enjoying his creation, sitting in peace. I was daydreaming at the time about my upcoming marriage to Joseph, But then, without anyone coming in, I knew without a shadow of a doubt that I was not alone as I had been the previous moment. I turned, looked into the room, and my breath caught in my throat, because there, standing by the fire, was the hugest man I had ever seen. "Greetings, you who are highly favoured," he said. "The Lord is with you." It was a really gentle voice from one so huge. And I'd never heard anything like it before. I've heard some greetings in my time, but I had no idea how to respond to that one. Highly favoured, me? I wasn't sure about that. And yes, I knew the Lord was with me. I'd just been enjoying his sun on my face and his peace as I thought about the future. But I wasn't really sure what this greeting meant. "Mary," he said, "do not be afraid." Strangely, as he said it, my heart slowed and I realised that I was not actually afraid, although perhaps that would have been an absolutely normal response. He continued talking. At the time, I was really grateful for that. I'm not sure I would have been capable of speech right then. "You have found favour with God," he said. "You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." I'll tell you what, that set my heart off again. Not with fear, really, but confusion. And was it excitement? How could this be? I knew at once what it meant. I knew, I don't really know how, that this was not just news that would change my life, but news that would change the world forever. And I thought perhaps this man, this thing, this angel, is that what it was? Perhaps he'd got the wrong house. Did that happen? Did angels get it wrong sometimes? Anyway, I knew with absolute certainty there was no way he was talking about me. Me? Have a baby? Not likely. I wasn't married yet. I was still a virgin. There was no way I was having a baby. And so I told him, not sure what I expected. Did I think he'd check his notes and pop off down the street to someone else? But no, he didn't. He remained absolutely sure. His eyes told me that he was sure of me and of his message. "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative," he said, "is going to have a child in her old age. And she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." As he finished speaking, it felt like our little house suddenly contained the whole of the universe and the whole of history. He was looking at me intently, waiting for an answer. I knew that I wouldn't be forced to do anything, but I knew I had to respond, but I couldn't speak. The news filled my heart and my soul. The Son of God, the Son of David. Our people had been talking about the Messiah for hundreds of years, through illness, through wars, through exile, through awful hardship. The stories had persisted and we had kept believing and hoping and trusting that God's promises would be fulfilled and we would be sent a Saviour, a Messiah, one who would restore God's people and change the world. And I knew in that moment with every fibre of my being that this is what the angel was talking about. All the hopes and dreams of our people over the years were held in his message. I felt fear and joy and hope, trepidation, inadequacy, and the utter absolute assurance that God was with me, all in the same moment. I was overwhelmed. I felt so small. And yet I also felt the hugeness of God and his love filling the room and filling me. And over and above all of that, I felt peace. I had no idea how, because I was also filled with the absolute knowledge that if I said yes to this, then my heart would be filled up, but it would also be broken. That this boy, my son, would not only change my life forever, but would change the course of history. I have no idea how long I sat there absorbing all this. But as the peace filled my soul, I heard myself say, I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled. And that was it. He smiled at me, seemed relieved, and he left. Left me sitting there. The peace remained, though, even as I sat there wondering how on earth I would explain this to my parents or to Joseph. My world had been turned upside down and the whole world had changed forever. And so the question is, having entered in to what that story might have been like for Mary all those years ago, what can we learn from it 2,000 years later, as this, the strangest, most emotional year, comes to an end? As we look forward to a Christmas that might be nothing like what we wanted or expected or hoped for or longed for. Well, I think I want to encourage us today to allow all of those emotions to happen. I like to think about what emotions the people in the Nativity story might have had as they approached the first Christmas. Nothing was quite like how they expected either. I would imagine there was fear, trepidation, apprehension as they approached what was happening. And so I don't want us to rush towards Christmas and the hope and the peace and the joy that we know Jesus brings. Yes, this is a time filled with all those things. Whatever personal or global circumstances we find ourselves in, the story of God remains constant. But let's not rush towards the hope of Christmas. By now, we'd probably normally be singing the most wonderful time of the year. God rest you, merry gentlemen. O come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Doesn't feel like such a wonderful time of year this year. I don't feel particularly joyful or triumphant. And I don't want to be one of those ones that rushes through Advent. I always try to pause in Advent, but often the pull of Christmas is too much. But this of all years, let's just wait in the anticipation of Advent. The season of Advent is a gift that I think we really need this year. Let's not be like those who see a chocolate Advent calendar and want to open all the doors at once and eat all the chocolate. But let's actually be those who are willing to sit with the longing and with the anticipation. Advent is the time for that longing and that anticipation. It's a time to make space, to not rush off, but to sit with those emotions that sometimes we try to run away from, with grief, with fear, with uncertainty. This year, perhaps more than most, and to travel slowly with the characters who make up the Christmas story, the story of God's salvation, and who, like Mary, knew that the world had changed, but didn't quite know what all of that might mean. Advent is the time when we sit with the yearning and the longing deep in our souls, for a time when God's kingdom will come in its fullness, when peace will fill the earth, where there is no more sadness or sickness or grief, We long for that day. We feel it in the pit and the depths of our souls. And Advent is the time to sit with that longing. And maybe importantly, more importantly, like Mary, we need to take the time to say, yes, yes, Lord. I myself will do whatever it takes to play my part in bringing your kingdom here on earth, in making you known. Even amongst the chaos, even amongst the mess, and nothing being quite as we planned it or want it, still, your kingdom come and your will be done. And so I want to pray a prayer, and then I think we're going to have a song from Catherine. And then we'll move into prayers again. As we pray, Holy God, just as we are, we come to you and ask for your kingdom to come to us and in our hearts and in our homes. Increase our faith and love for you so that we may become the lights in the darkness that we are called to be. Amen.
Did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you Heaven's perfect love.
Lord, we pray for those who are worried about uncertainties in their lives and things that are beyond their control. For those who are worried and anxious about where they will be spending Christmas, help them to trust in you in all things. And if we are unable to celebrate Christmas as we normally do, we pray for creativity to make this Christmas a joyful, special and memorable time of year.
Lord, we pray for the forthcoming week ahead, for there to be continued progress in the fight against coronavirus. We pray that you would guide the government in their decision making and the pharmaceutical companies in their efforts to perfect the vaccine. We pray for those who are feeling lonely, invisible or isolated, particularly following the lockdown. Help them to remember that you have a purpose for their lives, you are always with us, and that we can find comfort in you.
As we enter into the winter season, we thank you, Lord, for watching over us throughout the year and through all the seasons of our lives. We pray for those who have lost loved ones during this year, that you will strengthen them and bring them hope. We pray for those who are sick or have recently been diagnosed with a condition. Please grant them healing and nurture their continued faith in you.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
And so as our time here comes to an end, a prayer. God, may we hunger for justice like Mary. Choose love over law like Joseph. Celebrate your unreasonable grace like the angels. Run towards your mysteries like the shepherds, and search you out like the wise men. This Advent, this Christmas, and always. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you, be among those you love, now and always. Amen.
Thank you.
stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop.